spreading the gospel in power, truth, and love.
We come to convert, equip, empower, and send out the called and chosen of God. Are you called? Have you been chosen? Do you know your purpose?
These are the mysteries God wants to reveal to you. Apostle Anthony and Prophet Jennifer Stanley believes God is raising up a generation of leaders who will not bow down to the system of this world, but will stand up for righteousness and will duplicate the kingdom of God on the earth as it is in heaven. So join us for a right now word that will catapult you into your God-ordained destiny. Today is your day to break through and break forth with SKM, The Hub. Blessings. This is Apostle Anthony Stanley.
And this is Prophet Jennifer Stanley.
And you are watching SKM The Hub, where we convert, equip, empower, and send out the called and chosen of God. And we thank you so much for tuning in. We are excited today because we just know that in this episode, we're going to be discussing grace. And grace is amazing. The grace of God is amazing. And so we're going to discuss that. I know last episode we discussed our testimonies. We talked about how we came through and how God brought us through and what made us want to remain in God. And I think one of the things that we both kind of agreed in was it was His grace. It was His love that kept us and that brought us through, that helps us to say, you know what? We want to remain in Jesus because He loves us that much to look out for us, to keep us from falling. And so we are excited today. I know I am. I know Prophet Jennifer is too. And so we're going to discuss grace. Now, why is grace important? Well, let's look at the definition of grace. The definition of grace is the free and unmerited favor of God. And it's as manifested in the salvation of sinners and the bestowal of blessings. And so, Prophet Jennifer, talk about that favor.
I was just, you know, thinking that anytime we, you know how we like for people to show favor to us.
Yes.
And that's the same way with God. He loves for us to show favor and to love on Him. And when we do that, He also shows His favor with us because
exactly.
We do it the same way with people. When
they
show it to us, we show favor as well. And so Isaiah 66 and 2 tells us that it says, "My hands have made both heaven and earth. They and everything in them are mine. Mm. I, the Lord, have spoken. I will bless those who have humbled and contrite hearts, and those who tremble at my word." And so He was sharing with us that, you go ahead on and expound on that.
Because with that being said, I think I have something written down concerning that.
Okay.
With grace, because a lot of people don't understand grace. Some people think that grace is a card, like a continue to sin card. And it's okay to continue to do the things of the world and still be in God. That's not grace. But grace is always available for everyone. As long as you're breathing, there's still grace. And so what do I mean? Well, I want to say, who deserves grace? Well, none of us actually deserves grace. It was really just a free gift that God wanted to give us to restore us back to Himself. But the humble, just like this scripture, the humble, the broken spirit, the contrite heart. What does contrite mean? Well, a repentant heart is what always puts us first in line for His grace, for His favor, for His mercy, for Him to bring us out when we are in deep in our sins. And so let's go back into the beginning, okay? That way we can get a better understanding of what grace is. Well, in the beginning, God created man, as we know, in the book of Genesis, and then He had Adam. He created Adam. And Adam was living in a realm, so to say, just like heaven, but it was on the earth where he didn't have any troubles, he didn't have any worries, he didn't have any problems, he was prosperous. He had everything he could possibly desire, the gifts of the Spirit. He had it all. And so with that being said, God gave him a woman, Eve. And then when that took place, Eve was tempted. She ate from the tree that God told her not to eat of. And then all of a sudden, man falls away from God and they're in sin and they're cursed by sin. And they're no longer in that place that God had them, which was the Garden of Eden, but it represent undefiled earth. And so we are now in a defiled earth where sin chaos, destruction, and everything is around us. And so God made grace so that he can bring us back into that undefiled nature.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? To bring us into perfection. So he already established, before the foundations of the world, he already established the Lamb, which is Jesus Christ, to come and do that. And so that grace by Jesus Christ was made so that we can come back to him. Why am I saying that? Because the scripture tells me that. In 2 Corinthians, I believe, 4 and 15, it says, "For all things are your sakes, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God." What does redound mean? Well, redound means to come back. So to come back to the glory of God, the manifested presence of God, that place that was undefiled, he wants to bring us back. That's what grace does. It brings us back to that state.
It's like a drawing tool.
Yes.
It's a drawing tool because it lets us know that, you know, even though I've messed up, I've fallen short, I've sinned or whatever, the love of God, his grace, his mercy,
yes,
it draws me back in. And that's a powerful thing because I think we shared and talked about it on last week that some people will do away with you.
Yes.
Once you mess up or you cross them, they'll do away with you. But God's unmerited, his favor, his love, his grace, it's there to show you that even though you've messed up, I still love you.
Yes. And I love when you say favor because in the Hebrew, grace means favor. Mm-hmm. And what favor means is pretty much that you are preferred.
Yeah.
Before anyone else, you are preferred. And so God loved the human race so much so. Think about this, and I want to share this because it's just dropped in my spirit. And this will encourage you. Think about it. And so a lot of people think that God, the Bible contradicts itself and God contradicts himself and that he's not really a God of love. And who want to serve someone who doesn't accept everyone for being who they are and doing whatever they want to do, but he's just throwing down judgment and he's allowing destruction. He's allowing all of these things. Well, that's not the will of God. The will of God has nothing to do with destruction and all of that. He said in John 10 and 10, he came that we may have life and in it more abundantly. That is what his will is, but sin is what causes all those other things to take place. So when you look into the scriptures, you see, I think we talked about it in one of the other episodes about Noah, where God said it was going to rain. He told Noah that. And then the rain was to kind of wipe out all humanity and start all over again. But why would God do something like that? Well, we are his creation. Have you ever drew something before, like art? Or you ever made music, or you ever done something and it didn't come out the way you wanted it to be.
Mm-hmm.
And so what did you do? Well, you erased it and started over again, mm-hmm, to start something new. Well, God had to do the same thing. And so, but it was his grace to where now he don't destroy us anymore. He don't take us out or erase us out of the earth anymore. He's given us so much time to come back. And so that promise was the rainbow that he told Noah, I'm going to make a rainbow. And every time you see this rainbow, it's the promise that I'm not going to destroy the earth with water anymore. I'm not going to take out my people anymore. But he saw that the people wasn't being what he has ordained them and has made them to be in the first place. So he had to recreate again.
And I believe that, I don't know, I was just thinking that it probably hurt God to have to wipe out his entire creation.
Exactly.
Because he has so much love and compassion for us that it hurt him probably to have to wipe out the creation. And this is why he said, and before I do that again, I'll allow grace to be here in the earth.
Yes.
So I'll allow grace to come in the midst of your, you doing me wrong, in the midst of you walking away from me, in
yes,
the midst of you, you know, just bashing my name,
yes,
my love and grace will still be there for you.
Yes.
That's powerful.
And you got to think about it. Like I said, that word favor means preferred. So you are preferred. The human race, you think about it. This is God's greatest creation. We are God's greatest creation. He did not send Jesus to die for the plants.
Yeah.
He didn't send Jesus to die for the moon and the stars, nor did he send him to die for the animals. He sent Jesus to die for us.
Yes.
He said that He will take care of us. He said, even if he takes care of the sparrow, how much more will he take care of you, which you are more valuable than the sparrow, than a bird. So he loves us more than any of his other creations. And so that is why he have given us the grace to come back to him. And so, but what I want to share is that we talked about it in the beginning, that so many people have a different view about grace. Grace to some people is like a sin-free car. You do whatever you want to do and just sin and everything is all right because the grace covers it. But the scripture never says that you can do that. And so I want to go to Romans chapter 6, and I want to read some of this because Paul is giving us what grace really means, okay? And I'm only showing you this so that way we can get a better understanding so that we can be all who God called us to be with no limitations, nothing that will cause him to turn his face from us, but we are doing exactly what he wants us to do here on the earth. Even if you don't know him, this will be some great information to help you so that you can get to know him and truly see the true characteristics of our God, that he is a God of love. Okay, he's a God of grace and mercy, but he's also a God of righteousness, and he's a God of judgment, which he has to do that. In order for the world to be, for his people to be set in order, he has to have some sort of rules. He has to have some sort of regulations. If the whole world had a you can do whatever you want to do type of thing, we'd be in chaos. We need rules in place to keep us on the right path. And so Romans chapter 6 says, what shall we say then? This is the first verse. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. That is what Paul said. God forbids. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? What is he saying? How that we who've come into Christ. Now, this is not for the sinner. Okay, this is for those who are in Christ now that has taken grace for granted. He's saying, how shall we that are supposed to be dead to sin continue to live in sin and say that grace abounds? No, Lord forbids. We can't do that because that basically meaning, and he'll say it pretty much, that's pretty much saying that we are putting Jesus back on the cross. We don't need to put him back on the cross. He have already died for all of our sins. And so what grace does, oh man, what grace does, it gives you access to sit in heavenly places with Christ Jesus so that your perspective of the world is like his. What do I mean? Well, when you see the world, you see chaos, you see sin, you see all of these different things that's in the world that the prince of the world, which is Satan himself, is influencing people to do. But when you sit in Jesus' perspective, you and sit in heavenly places with him and you're looking at it from his point of view, you see the world in a different light. You see the world being the way he designed it to be. You see the world where sin is no longer present. You see the world in a way that Jesus sees it, and so you won't even partake in the things that's here. So grace empowers you to live sin-free or to live perfect in God.
And I believe that, like, again, it's a card to show you this is where you messed up at,
yes,
but I still love you. Because if you continue in your ways, and yes, see, this is the problem. We, including me, have used the grace card so many times. Yeah. Well, God knows my heart. Yes, he does. He knows your heart. But then let's look at Psalms 37, 23 and 24. It says, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord,
yes,
and he delighteth in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down. The Lord upholded him with his hand. Why did he say that? Because this is a person who have acknowledged their wrong, have acknowledged that I messed up, and I have come back to you humbly,
yeah,
with the mindset that I'm not going to go do it again.
Exactly.
But see, the problem is we don't come back with the mindset that I'm not going to do it again.
Yes.
We go with, oh, God's grace is sufficient.
Yes.
God's grace is going to keep on being here for me.
Yeah.
But the problem is that you find a lot of people now that's struggling in life, in their Christian walk. Why are you struggling? Because you're still pulling the grace card. I had to put down that card and face reality that if I want my ways to be delighting in God's sight,
yes,
I'm going to have to take some responsibilities for some of the things that I'm doing. Yes. Because he tells us here, he said that a good man's steps are ordered by the Lord.
Yes.
And then he said, it says here that even if, and if you keep reading the scripture, even if I fall, the Lord will uphold me, meaning he will pick me back up, because a just man falls how many times?
Seven.
A just man falls. So I'm not the righteous. I'm not this person that's going to sit here and act like I'm so perfect, because I'm not.
Yes.
But his grace card comes in and shows me this is where you need to get it right at.
Exactly.
And once he do that, now it's my job not to continue in my same stuff, because then I'm putting Jesus back on the shelf.
So my question would be, and I know everyone is thinking that probably, that are watching, and those who have already thought it and wanted to ask somebody but never got a chance to do that. Well, does God's grace run out? Does God's grace run out? Well, in my heart, I really believe, yes, God's grace runs out. Now, you got to look at it in the spirit, though. You can't look at it in the fleshly standpoint. Because right now, in the physical realm, we're here on the earth, okay? But when we transition into the glory, which is the afterlife, where our spirit man dwells and lives, grace is no longer needed. So that means as long as I'm here on the earth, grace is available. But as soon as I take my last breath and transition, grace is no longer available. Yeah. So that lets me know that grace does run out. Mm-hmm. And so you have to make the best of your time here on the earth by accepting the grace of God, so that when you transition, you're not looking for grace to keep you from going into a place you don't want to be in.
Right.
Okay? And for me to even mention that, you already know we're talking about we're talking about heaven and we're talking about hell. There's a difference between the two. Your main goal should be, I want to make it to heaven. I don't want to go to hell. Well, hell wasn't designed for you in the first place.
Right.
It was designed for the angels, for the fallen angels. It was designed for Satan himself. It wasn't designed for you. But it'll be your choice to go if you decide to say, I reject the grace of God, and I don't want to get my life together.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what that does.
And even when you bring that into this terms right now, when we've reached our wit end,
yes,
when we've constantly, we gave an example, when you're working, I mean, not working a job, but when you have an apartment or home, or let's just use an apartment. When you don't pay your rent constantly, you don't pay your rent. Every apartment or leasing, wherever you're leasing at or whatever, renting from, allows you a grace period,
a
correct?
A grace period,
so
yes.
Whether it's the fifth of the month, the eighth of the month, you get a grace period. Now, if you continue to break your grace period, if you continue to be late on your rent or whatever payment, what happens?
They send you a letter.
For eviction.
Yes.
So then that qualifies to say that grace has ran out. Because now they no longer want to hear anything you have to say, because you've made so many excuses.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how we have to look at things, because you're making excuses. I've made excuses, so many excuses why I can't do this, or God, you keep, you know, it seems like every time God brings me out of a situation, I go back in. Why? You know why? And I want to bring this in, because I have not delighted myself in his ways.
Oh, yes,
when
that's good.
When he showed me that Jennifer, you messed up so many times, I can't even count on my hand or my toes. You've messed up so many times, but yet I keep bringing you in. But then there was one time that God shared with me. He said, you have two choices, either jail or the grave. And I think I shared that last time, because he was letting me know that while you're here on earth, there is a time where I say I'm fed up.
Yeah.
You need to make a decision. And so some people say, well, hopefully that person, and I'm just going to say it, they'll say, well, hopefully that person, when they were dying or whatever, got to say, God, forgive me. I don't know. In my heart, I feel like let's say I was drunk and I was on drugs when this happened and I just died. Did I get a chance to say, Lord, forgive me
exactly
for my sins and I accept you?
Right. What if I never knew him?
What if I never knew him?
What if I never said anything at all?
Exactly.
Exactly. Where am I going?
Where am I going?
Yeah.
Did I miss my grace?
Exactly.
Because when judgment come, can judgment and grace abide together?
Yeah. See, this is what needs to be spoken, because we shared it in a couple episodes before that we are not living in, you know, the greatest times of our lives, so people saying. We are getting close to the coming of our Lord and Savior. And so a decision has to be made. Mm-hmm. And so that's why we're talking about the grace, to let you know that God's arms are open, ready to receive. Any one of you that's watching, every person, I don't care who you are, I don't care what you're doing, I don't care what you have done, His arms are still open because you're breathing.
Yeah.
And so you can come to Him right now if you want to. Mm-hmm. You can come to Him. But it's your decision, your choice. He's not going to force you to do it, because that's why He's given us free will for that very reason, so that we can say, you know what? Hey, I don't want it. All right. He's okay with that. He respects your choices just as much as the other person respects their choices or respect your choices. And so, but God wants you to have a choice, because how much greater would it be for you to say, I choose Jesus?
Yeah.
Over everything else, it says, I choose Him. I don't choose anyone else. I don't choose nothing else. I just want Him.
Well, even in Psalms 37 and 18, it says, a good man's days are forever.
Yeah.
And it says, the Lord knoweth the days of the upright.
Yes.
And their inheritance shall be forever.
Yes.
So when I actually get to the place where I acknowledge who He is and I accept Him, guess what happens?
Mm.
Everything I do will be ordered by Him.
Yes.
Because I acknowledge Him. And then this is the other thing He said, will be forever. So we know that when I leave this earth, I got another inheritance. I may have an inheritance here, but when I leave here, I have an inheritance up there too.
Yes.
And it says it's forever. It's for eternity.
My gosh, yes.
So my grace period, I won't even need it once I leave, because
no.
First of all, I established my grace, His grace here, His
yes.
love here.
Yes.
And I'm taking it with, I don't need it with me when I leave, but I've embraced it here. So that when I leave this place, I'm going to see the King.
Exactly. You prepared yourself for the transition.
Exactly.
I prepare myself for the transition. That's the purpose. While we're here, is to prepare for the transition. We are going to experience heaven. Those who know Jesus, those who have accepted Him, those who know this grace and have not took it for granted, but really realize that it was only Him who brought us out, and that we're going to serve Him for the rest of our days. When we begin get to the end of the times, we're going to transition, and we're going to know our King. We're going to serve. We're going to be closer than we ever been before with Him.
Mm-hmm.
But those who have not accepted Him and don't know Him, they are afraid of the transition.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can't be. You will never be afraid of the transition when you know that it's real.
Mm-hmm.
But when you don't think it's real, see, this is what I want to say, because I sense it in my heart to share this, that. This is the main thing. Now, regardless if you believe in Jesus Christ or not, mm-hmm. there is so much evidence to let us know that there's a God that exists.
Mm-hmm.
The air, the wind, the earth itself, the galaxy, the solar system, all the animals, everything. You just know for sure. Creation itself
mm-hmm.
lets us know that there has to be something bigger out there. It's a God that exists. And so, think about this. Would you rather believe, I would rather believe in a God that I believe exists, but if I would pass away and He didn't exist, I would rather die believing than die not believing at all, and then it happens to be real.
Mm-hmm.
You get what I'm saying here?
Mm-hmm.
It's best that you believe now and choose now. And say, you know what? I want to take Him up for that offer. I want that grace. I want that gift that He's given me.
That's good. But so who comes to stop us from believing in that?
My gosh.
Our adversary.
Yes.
Your adversary, the enemy. Anything that comes to confront your purpose and your call and where God has designed for you. Anything that comes to tell you you can continue to abide in this. If you continue in this, oh, God is so forgiving.
Yeah.
Never requiring you to make a change.
Yes.
Never challenging you to step outside of that comfort zone.
Yes.
So when this thing, I keep falling short, I keep fornicating, I keep drinking, I keep doing all this. I kept doing all of
yeah.
that. Okay, so when I kept doing this, who was stopping me from embracing God's true grace.
Right.
The enemy.
It was the adversary.
My adversary. He was trying to stop me, and to this day, we're in a spirit battle with him.
Yes.
He's trying to stop us from receiving God's true grace, not man's grace,
yeah,
but God's true grace.
Yeah, because God's true grace, like she stated, never fails.
Never fails.
It never fails. In Lamentations 3:22, it says, "It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed." Mm-hmm. We're still living. We are not consumed. He said, "Because his compassions fail not." Mm-hmm. His grace fails not. Mm-hmm. His love fails not. And so you got to keep that in mind, that it's because of his grace that brought us through. The enemy, he snatches the truth from us.
Yeah.
He wants you to not believe.
Yeah.
You know why? So that when it's time to transition and you go into a place you don't want to be, so he can torment you with the very thought that you didn't, that you waited too long to see the truth.
And I know you're going to pray, but if I could share a time where I needed God's grace, when his grace came in, was, I'll never forget, we were in this apartment, and I was with my auntie, and it was a group of us. We had gotten high and drunk, and we were all asleep. And the guy next door apartment caught on fire. Well, when his apartment caught on fire, the smoke began to, you know, it went through the entire building, but it was so thick. If the Lord had not awakened my uncle to shake everybody up and get us out of there, we would have all died.
Mm.
When I went downstairs, the fire, I don't know how we made it out, but the fireman, he said, "There is no way that you all should have made it out of this building."
Mm.
What if I would have died and went to hell?
Yeah, yeah.
I would have died that night and went straight to hell.
Yeah, yeah. But it was his grace.
His grace.
And so I'm going to pray. Yeah. I'm going to pray for those who do not believe in the Lord.
Yes.
I want to pray for you to receive him today for salvation. Just close your eyes, bow your head, and just open up your heart. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. I bless you for those who are watching, those who are tuned in. Lord, I ask you right now to just release your presence upon them. Let them feel your grace and your mercy and your love. Let them know that your arms are open. The word has been spoken, so faith is increased in them. So God, begin to make their hearts flesh. Begin to soften their hearts right now. And so as your eyes are closed and your head is bowed, if you want to receive them, repeat these words after me. Say, "Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. Forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Purify my heart so that I can live for you. I know that you died on the cross for my sins. I know that whenever this earth passes away and whenever the time for you to return, you're going to return just for me. If I was the only one there that was there during the times you died on the cross, you would have still went on the cross just for me." And so if you prayed that prayer, and if you truly meant it in your heart, then you are saved. And so we thank God and bless the Lord for that. And so we just pray that you've been encouraged from this word today. Grace is a powerful thing. Grace is what empowers us to live holy and righteous for the Lord. So keep that in mind, okay? And so we're still doing our Wednesday Nights of Fire at Eastland Suites. At 1907, which is the address, 1907 North Cunningham Avenue at 6 p.m. every Wednesday. We've been doing some awesome teachings. We're looking for leaders to come that want to learn more. We're also looking for those who don't know their purpose, those who want to take a step into ministry but don't know how. Come, please. We're here to encourage you, to empower you, and to send you out. And so also, if you have prayed that prayer, give us a call and let us know. We want to help you. We want to pray for you at 217-358-3469. Or visit our website, www.serenitykingdomministries.com. God bless you. Thank you so much for tuning in.